you know, I'm going to jump right into Washington, and you called it yesterday the rebalancing toward Asia that the Obama administration has announced with much fanfare, but has not always had the easiest of time actually turning from strategic goal into reality. Just this week, of course, we have these events in Iraq. We have this incredible tension in Eastern Europe between Russia and Ukraine, distracting the president, the vice president. It seems like we're in a crisis a day mode, never mind Afghanistan. Do you feel out of sync coming to Washington? What is the message about Asia that you're bringing?
The message is you are a superpower. You have far-flung concerns and interests all around the world. But Asia is vital to you, and you are a Pacific power, have always been and will always be. And amidst tending all the other issues, please bear in mind that in Asia you have interests, you have friends, you have investments, and you have to pay due attention to it in terms of resources, in terms of mind share, and in terms of explanation to the public, the population, why this is important and how it can make a difference to America.
But is it really a strategic pivot? I guess that's sort of the big question, is how is it possible, given all the crises in the world and the U.S. unique role? The struggles of the last few years are sort of a good reminder of our difficulty in taking a long strategic pivot.
You have issues all over the world, but that doesn't mean you are completely equally distributed in all directions. I mean, in Asia, you may or may not have hot things going on at any one time. I mean, there are some hot issues too. North Korea can become hot. The territorial disputes, the island disputes have warmed up significantly over the last couple of years. But there are also long-term, secular, crucial trends which are going to change the world. China is developing. Its influence is growing in the world. Its weight economically is already one of the biggest economies. The other countries in Asia are also linking up, cooperating with one another more, trading with one another more, developing a framework for the international relations within Asia. And America has to be part of this. If you're not part of this, I think you're going to find many of your interests will be affected and maybe even compromised.
Some people have even talked of a sort of neo-isolationist strain within American politics over the last few years. People in both American political parties being tired of the burden, if you will, of global leadership. Do you find yourself having to make the case when you go up to Capitol Hill and you visit here in Washington that America should even still be engaged?
Well, I think that there is a mood like that in America. You talk about it, it's all over your media, your opinion polls show it, and your congressmen and senators have to reflect this mood because they have to be in sync with the population. But America has been through these ups and downs before. After Vietnam, you had a period of withdrawal and being tired of the sacrifices and the pain and the difficulties of the world. But you bounce back, and I'm quite sure you will bounce back this time. And what I'm trying to do is to register with people who are interested and who count that you have to... Well, it's unavoidable that you are feeling how you feel now, but you have to move on beyond that. And the sooner you can come out from this mood, the better it is for America.
Although, if you look at our political calendar, unfortunately, it suggests that we might spend the next few years talking more in the other direction. You know, I know you're here to talk to people about the TPP and trade, for example, you know, as we move closer and closer toward an American presidential election season.
Well, you've always got some election on the horizon. It's either the presidential election or the midterms. Mm-hmm. And so you've got to try and time your non-election moves in the windows which are available where people can focus their minds and you can get policy pushed through, and the TPP is one very important piece of it. Mm-hmm. And the administration has made it very clear that it is one of their top priorities in Asia to get the TPP negotiated, agreed, and then ratified. and we have to leave it in their good hands to decide what is the best timing in your electoral calendar.
What is your sense, having been here for a few days and talked with people, what is your best sense at the moment of the political prospects for the TPP, and also in terms of the negotiations? I know the negotiations will resume next week, I believe, in Canada.
The negotiations will continue. They have made a lot of progress, so these are the last few steps. There are some difficult issues yet to be resolved. I mean, the Japanese particularly have got some sacred subjects which have to be talked about: beef, sugar, dairy products, and rice, for example, pork.
The full dinner menu.
Well, yes, but there are other things in life apart from dinner, and we've made progress on those. So I'm hopeful that the agreement can be settled this year. I think everybody is trying very hard, and I know the Japanese do want to settle. Then it has to be ratified. I don't have a feel for whether it can be. I'm told that people think that in the House they would be able to have the votes. In the Senate, well, it depends on the Senate leadership, and it depends who the Senate leadership is, because your midterms are coming, and after that, well, you're not quite sure what the composition will be. So we'll have to see.
Would a Republican Senate be better? Historically, certainly.
Historically, yes, but now you have the Tea Party and the group who are a different kind of Republican. So it's hard to say how the numbers stack up.
On the negotiations and this question of the Japanese, it does seem like there's been much more success in bringing the other 11 parties together, and the New Zealand Prime Minister was just here as well, I believe, and suggested that perhaps we should make a deal without the Japanese.
The New Zealanders are very, very anxious to have a deal, because for them the TPP is the only game. For the other countries, there are various other FTAs which they belong to, and Singapore, for example, has an FTA with the US already. For the New Zealanders, the only way to do that is through the TPP. Mm-hmm. So they want the TPP come hell or high water. Mm-hmm. But from a strategic point of view, I think it is very important that the Japanese be in on the TPP, because they are your key strategic partner of the US in Asia. You have a security alliance with them, your ties with China now, probably the volume is greater, but you have to maintain that link with Japan. And if you leave them out from the TPP or drop them, having invited them to negotiate, I think that's very bad.
And just quickly, in terms of the calendar, I know President Obama has spoken of by November wanting to have at least the contours of the real deal in place. Does that seem realistic to you?
We've had several deadlines over the last couple of years. We haven't hit all of them, but they have helped us to push forward. I think we should take this deadline very seriously, and I believe we have a very good chance of settling it by November.
Mm-hmm. So you talked about the strategic implications of the trade deal. Looking more broadly at the strategic picture in Asia right now, you've had some very interesting things to say about both what's going on with the Japanese and the Chinese. You face challenges with these two big regional powers, clearly, that raise the question of what role the United States can continue to play in the region, either balancing off of those, negotiating resolution to some increasingly loud disputes.
You have very important relations with both Japan and with China. With Japan, you have the security alliance, which has been since the Second World War, and it is both a reassurance to Japan as well as a restraint, because with that security alliance, it means Japan has a nuclear umbrella and doesn't have to think about providing its own nuclear capabilities. And I think that is a stabilizing factor for the whole region. With China, your relationship has grown very considerably. The trade is one of your biggest trading partners. The interdependence goes both ways. The Chinese invest in America just as you invest in China. They buy your treasury bills and US government securities. They depend on America as a source of technology, of ideas, as a destination for many of their most promising young people to go to study. Mm-hmm. So you have a lot of positive elements in your bilateral relationship. And you have to manage the difficulties which come up, whether it's territorial and maritime disputes, whether it's exchange rates or human rights, in such a way that it doesn't skew the whole relationship in the wrong direction.
You talked recently about the problem of the South China Sea and China's territorial claims there and not wanting to assert the privilege that basically might can prevail over right, and that this should be settled within the framework of international
law. Yes.
Do you see any reasonable prospects for that occurring anytime soon?
I think it is something which is going to take a very long time to resolve, because no country will lightly give up its territorial claims. It's politically very difficult to do, and so you end up with an impasse. So I think that for a resolution will take a very long time. On the other hand, you have to live with the situation where it is without leading to frictions or encounters and incidents and escalation on the ground, which can easily happen. Ships bump into one another, a boat is sunk, sailors are killed, or aeroplanes bump into one another. Something wrong can easily go wrong. Therefore, there has to be some code of conduct which we all abide by. So while we, until such time as we solve the problem and agree on where to draw the lines, we exercise restraint and we manage the problem and prevent it from flaring up.
Well, that's what's been so hard to watch from the distance of Washington over the last few years, I think, is this perceived escalation of the risk of one of those catastrophic events, like ships bumping into each other.
Yes.
It feels as though we've reached a new point where we don't actually know what the rules are.
Well, I think that definitely if we look at it over the last 2-3 years, tensions have risen, mm-hmm. both in the South China Sea as well as on the Senkaku Tiaoyu Islands. Mm-hmm. And that's a bad thing, and ASEAN is quite concerned about this. So is Singapore. So we've been counseling moderation and manage this until you can resolve it, but act in accordance with international law and including the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea.
Do you think, in a big picture sense, when you see what happened on the other side of the world this winter and spring with Ukraine and Russia, and the idea that the Russians basically seized a portion of another country's territory, has any kind of a spillover effect in Asia? Do people look at this and say, there's an unraveling of the international order?
Well, we think it's a bad precedent. It is not the right thing to do when a country can march in and take over another piece, a piece of somebody else's country, and particularly in contravention of international agreements which have already been reached, which they were party to. Because in this case, there was an agreement guaranteeing Ukraine's boundaries, which Russians were party to, so was the French, so were the British, and Ukraine, and America. And it was in exchange for Ukraine giving up its nuclear weapons. So for that not to count for anything, I think that's a very bad international precedent. And it has implications all around the world.
When you think about, you know, what tools and mechanisms do we have, whether it's in Ukraine or in the South China Sea, let's just say that one of these bad scenarios occurs, a mistake, an accident between two ships, there's very little likelihood that the Security Council is going to act with the threat of a veto by China and Russia hanging over any possibility. So it's hard to see what any kind of international dispute resolution mechanism even exists anymore.
Well, theoretically, there are dispute resolution mechanisms. Territorial disputes can be taken to the International Court of Justice at The Hague. In fact, Singapore has gone to The Hague over such a dispute with Malaysia, and it was resolved, and we both accepted the outcome. Maritime disputes can be taken to the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, which has a tribunal in Hamburg. And in fact, the Filipinos have done that. They've referred an issue to the ITLOS tribunal for adjudication. So there are mechanisms, but it is not often that big powers submit themselves to such international authorities. America doesn't often submit itself to these.
You're not a member of the Law of the Sea Convention.
Indeed, you have. Well, you signed, but you didn't ratify.
Exactly.
And successive presidents have advocated ratification, but Congress has not moved. And I think that that's really not the best posture for America to take.
Pulling back more, just looking at the big picture of the region as you see it, you have China, which we've discussed. Japan, there's also been a rise of nationalism.
Yes.
You talked about the rising tensions with South Korea, for
yes.
example, this reopening, this constant reopening of World War II and its tragic history.
Yes.
How much of a negative consequence does that have on the region?
Well, I think it is not helpful. We ought to be able to put these historical facts behind us and move forward. Nobody will forget them or should forget them, but neither should you be trapped by them. And you should be able to move forward and cooperate with each other despite this, as the Europeans have succeeded in doing between the French and the Germans. Well, the war was a brutal and nasty business, but they are now allies, not without many areas of argument, but nobody can imagine them going to war again. But in Asia, we have not had that coming to terms with the past and that ability to move forward. Some years ago, in I think 2007, 2008, the Chinese Premier Wen Jiabao visited Tokyo, and he made a speech in the Japanese Diet, and he said, well, we must move forward, and our history of friendship long exceeds our history of enmity. And therefore, let's put this behind us and move forward and work together. But unfortunately, relations have since then soured again, which is a great pity.
Do you see China obviously is going through a period of great transition? It still has a relatively new leadership. What is your view of the path that China is on right now? I think there's been some questions about, you know, how aggressively it will reform, whether political reform is possible.
I think they are working hard. I think the new leadership has established itself faster than people expected. They've worked out a comprehensive scheme for the reforms they want to carry out, which they adopted at the third plenum this year in March. They know what they need to do domestically. I think they have some idea of where they want to be internationally. Whether they can do it is difficult to say because it's a very big system and there will be inertia and pushback, but I think they are quite clear what they want to achieve, especially on the economic part, where you can have a good roadmap. When the social reforms, the political reforms, they will have to feel their way forward, but I think they know that the status quo is not tenable. For the international angle, the challenge is, on the one hand, they want to defend what they see as legitimate interests of theirs. On the other hand, they also know that if they assert themselves by might rather than through acceptance by other countries, in the long term, this is not good for China or for the world. And how they find that balance, we're still waiting to see. It is not going to be an easy balance to strike because it's not just the leadership, but it's also the whole mood of the society, the population. And nowadays in China, there's public opinion to worry about. They have the internet, and people have the equivalent of Twitter, Weibo, and netizens in any country are seldom a moderating force.
Now, you talked about the status quo not necessarily being tenable in the long term for China. There was just the anniversary of the Tiananmen Square incident, which, of course, was much discussed here in the United States and around the world, not so much in China, which went out of its way to make sure those netizens weren't able to have a free discussion of those tragic events. Do you see the possibility for a more peaceful version of the kind of movement toward free speech and democratic reforms that really has been squashed ever since then?
Well, actually, if you look at it in objective, absolute terms, there's a lot more speech and a lot more free discussion in China than there ever has been. Mm-hmm. There are restrictions, the internet is censored, there's a great Chinese firewall, but the average Chinese citizen has many more sources of information and many more opportunities to express his views and to participate in debate than 10 or 10, even 5 years ago. There are some no-go areas. You cannot question the rule of the Communist Party. You cannot debate whether Tibet can be independent or not, or autonomous, or Taiwan. But other than those, on many, many issues, in fact, the Chinese have been very open, and it's a very diverse society. It's not a monolithic totalitarian system, which some Westerners sometimes have an impression of. It's not correct. And if you talk to them, you will find that they're very open and they will speak. Now, how do you take the next steps which will lead to channeling these views and these mass attitudes into the political system so that the leaders respond to them in a more formal way? That's what they have to work out. You can see it happen in other societies. The Vietnamese, for example, they are a communist system. The Communist Party will be in charge, and there's no election with another party. But within the party, there's a lot of discussion. Within their parliament, there's debate, there's criticism of the government. And they've even had, even the prime minister has had to apologize for mistakes in the parliament. So there are ways it can be done. But they'll have to experiment and find out which one works for China.
Do you think the wave of instability that we've seen in the Middle East in the wake of those Arab Spring protest movements of a few years ago, has that set back the cause of democratization in Asia? Does that have an effect on these processes that, you're talking about, which are much slower and much more internal?
Well, when the Arab Spring came along, everybody thought that the 100 flowers were going to blossom. And it hasn't turned out to be so simple, and in fact, it's a very difficult business to remove a dictatorship and replace that with something better. Mm-hmm. You can pull down the old regime, but how do you make sure that what replaces it is not anarchy or a new authoritarian government? That is much, much more difficult to do. And I think in China, then fear is not of change, but of disorder. Mm-hmm. And I can understand that, because
I'm sure that's a concern that you have as well.
Well, every country has to find a way to manage its affairs in this new globalized internet age. It's much harder, but we have to do it because the world has changed, and we are not going back to where we were 50 years ago.
Before we wrap up, I wanted to sort of come back to Washington for a moment. As you, you of course have a long history here. What are some of the most common misconceptions that you hear when you come to Washington about what's happening in Asia right now? What are we missing or not getting right as we think about the region and its place in the world?
I think we don't always realize how much goodwill there is in the region for America. You've been there a long time. You've been there doing business. You've been there with the 7th Fleet. You've been there diplomatically. The president has visited. And it's not always a hot part of the world, so it's not always at the top of your mind. I mean, when you had Vietnam, it was the top of your mind, and you don't want to have that kind of a situation.
That's not a good
country. That's not a good model. But while it is peaceful and developing, you do need to know that there are many people in Asia and many countries in Asia which greatly appreciate what the American United States can contribute in terms of stability, in terms of prosperity, in terms of soft power, and who depend on the US to do that. And if you didn't do that, you're missing out and probably going to miss, do less well than you should do out of a story which is going to be a very big part of the 21st century.
And what do you think, in terms of when you go around to Beijing and the other capitals in the region, what are they misunderstanding about the United States? I think there is a question about whether China's betting on American decline, for example.
Well, that's one of it. I mean, I think many of them don't realize how resilient the United States is, and they think that after the global financial crisis, you're done for, and, suitable obsequies will be spoken, and then the new power will rise. I've told them when I've had a chance to that it's not so, and this is a very resilient country, and it has tremendous energy and creativity and drive, and it's going to bounce back. It may be now tired of wars and battles, but it will come back. It has done so before. I think there's also a perception in China particularly that America is trying to circumscribe it, restrict it, even contain it, anyway thwart it from taking its rightful place in the world. I don't think any American leader wants to do that. I don't think any American think tank believes that is feasible. But I believe that there will be anxiety in America, wondering what does the rise of America of China portend? How will it fit in? How will it affect American power and influence? So these are confidence-building steps which need to be taken in order that you can have a stable, long-term relationship between America and China.
Yes, no, that is at the heart of the misconception. I remember when the Pivot to Asia article first came out that Secretary Clinton wrote in Foreign Policy magazine, the magazine that I edited at the time, and all of the Chinese that I encountered after that just absolutely read it and saw it as a recipe for containment,
yes.
Which has become this sort of toxic
yes.
word in
yes.
conversation.
Yes.
You've quizzed both sides about it. You think containment is the wrong way of thinking about it?
No, I think the Americans know that it's not going to work because nobody is going to help you to contain them. And you can't do it yourself. And all the Asian countries want to work with China, want to prosper with China, want to take advantage of the opportunities which China is offering them. And America, too, is also deeply engaged with China. How can you contain them? With Russia, you had negligible trade or exchange.
But that's our biggest partner in the global
world. Yes, indeed. So how can you possibly do that? So it's not doable, but nevertheless, that lack of confidence in the other, that lack of trust in the other, is there and is an issue which has to be addressed. And I think it's being addressed because the president has spent time with Xi Jinping, and last year he had the Sunnyvale summit in California, and you've got the strategic economic dialogue between your treasury and state secretaries and their counterparts in China. And you have to have these top-level engagements, but actually it would also be helpful to have engagements lower down the line in the government services, in the armed services.
In particular the military,
so that you don't get the mismeasure of each other, which can lead to wrong assessments and missteps.
I mean, that's one thing that I've consistently heard from people here, in particular in our national security establishment, is just that we don't have the kinds of robust person-to-person military ties
yes.
That would be crucial in a conflict, but also just in more understanding. That,
yes.
That our real relationships are over here on the economic side, but that our problems are in places where we don't have
yes.
Robust relationships.
Yes. And that's a gap which needs somehow to be addressed. I think there's apprehension and reserve on both sides, maybe on the Chinese side more than the American one. But we should encourage them to open up and come forward. We have a Shangri-La dialogue in Singapore, which meets once a year. We've just had it at the end of May, beginning of June. And the U.S. SecDef usually comes. And the Chinese are represented, not quite at the same level, but this year the vice minister came from the foreign ministry. There was a senior general who came. And we hope that that will develop into a useful opportunity where you have contact. But it can't be the only one. You need more.
So just a final question to come back here one last time. You're going over to the White House this afternoon. You'll see senior officials, I guess. Vice
I'm seeing Susan Rice and Vice President Biden. Mm-hmm.
You'll be happy to not be talking about Iraq for part of their day.
Well, I hope they'll be able to take their minds off Iraq and spend some time talking about Asia. Vice President Biden was in Singapore last year. We had a very good visit by him. Susan Rice, I think, has not been to Singapore, but I hope I'll be able to invite her to come.
I'm sure she'll want to do that.
Yes.
There's been a lot of conversation and questioning and criticism of President Obama's foreign policy. That's the nature of our system. But there has been a persistent critique that really I've heard from both Democrats and Republicans about the question of whether we continue to assert a kind of leadership role in the world that obviously we're trying very hard to pull away from the militarized foreign policy of the last few decades. We're trying to end the wars of the last post 9/11 era. But President Obama, to many, hasn't seemed to project a new vision for what this new kind of leadership.
It's not easy to lead in the world today. On the one hand, people want America to take the initiative. On the other hand, when America moves, they say, there you are, you're squashing people. So. And on the part of the American population, they want to see leadership. On the other hand, they don't want to see entanglement. And they are not keen to be involved in new adventures. So the psychology is conflicted, and Mr. Obama has a very difficult job. But there is really no substitute for the Americans to engage in this, engage in the world, whatever the difficulties, because if you don't do that, it's going to be a much less hospitable world for you. And for many, many other countries all over the world.